So thanks, guys, for joining us today for this special Startup and Angels Online, this fourth session about emerging markets during COVID-19. So I'm really happy to have you all on board. We have speakers today from Nepal, Papua New Guinea, Indonesia, Cambodia, Australia, so all around APAC and Southeast Asia. Thanks, guys, for joining. I know it's not the same time where you are, 11 here in Sydney, 6:45 something in Nepal. Thanks, Binit, for joining so early. Thanks as well so for all the attendees joining in right now. They are joining on Zoom as well on other platforms. We'll record this event so you can hear it and view it after the event. The event is organized by Australians, so thanks Leo and the team for organizing it. You can check more about Australians on australians.com. And Startup and Angels, for those who don't know, so we've been doing events, physical events before the COVID-19 for more than 3 years, with thousands of attendees, hundreds of speakers, and in many countries and locations around the world. We've been organizing events in Nepal, Cambodia, Papua New Guinea, of course Australia, and other countries. Don't forget as well to register on our Startup and Angels community. So we just built this new community recently to manage the networking session and things like that during the COVID-19 outbreak. Without further ado, I'll leave the speakers to introduce themselves first. So we'll speak around the emerging markets, startups, entrepreneurs, and ecosystem during this COVID-19 outbreak. And I'll let Samson introduce himself. Welcome, Samson. Thanks for joining.
Hi, everyone. And thanks, Axel, for hosting. My name is Samson Korowali, and I am representing Relay and GoFood PNG today. I come from a technology background, so building technology hands-on. Working in the industry for over 15 years now, and I've been a full-time entrepreneur for just under 10 years, running my various tech companies in Papua New Guinea and in Australia.
Thanks, Samson. Welcome, Max. Max is French as well, same as me. You recognize the accent, I guess, and he's from Cambodia. Welcome, Max, if you can introduce yourself as well.
Hello, everybody. I'm Maxime Rosberger. I'm from France. I run the startup Meal Temple Group, which is a food delivery active in Cambodia, Laos, Myanmar, and Bhutan. And I speak today from Phnom Penh.
Thanks, Max. Welcome, Adi, from Indonesia.
Hi, good to see you, guys. I hope you are doing well. I'm so happy to be here. Introduce myself. My name is Adi Susanto, and I am a VP of Infrastructure and Product Innovation from Jagoan Hosting Indonesia. We are one of the biggest hosting providers at Indonesia. We provide infrastructure and platform to make people go online. Some of our products is like domain hosting, VPS, and other website services. Okay, that's it.
Thanks, Adi, and please welcome Binit. Binit just woke up really early here in Kathmandu. Binit from Bassobas.
Hi, Axel. Hi, guys. I'm really glad to be here. Thank you for inviting me. My name is Binit Sharma. I'm the co-founder of Bassobas.com. It's a proptech company in Nepal. We run a marketplace as well as SaaS CRM. And really glad to join you guys. Hope you'll do great.
Thanks, guys. Thanks. So The goal today is to speak about the COVID-19 outbreak in the different countries you are in. Let's start with Samson again. So if you can give us some, I know you're living so in Australia, but you're really active as well in Papua New Guinea. So if you can give us some insights and views about how it's going there in Papua New Guinea and how you compare it with how it's going for startups as well in Australia. Thanks.
Thanks, Axel. Well, the COVID-19 situation is quite interesting because it really depends on what industry you're working in. And for the online food business, GoFood PNG, it's actually been really successful. We've ramped up our orders because there are curfews in place. People can't move around, so they have to somehow eat and get food. So I think with the restaurants that we partnered with, they're all closed. However, they're allowed to order on our platform so that the deliveries can take place. So with our online delivery system, it's been very, very good. We've actually ramped up staff. We've got 3 more extra new full-time staff. So we're now 11 full-time staff with GoFood PNG. And we've noticed a lot of orders coming through from restaurants to groceries and even catering services. So that's actually been very good for us. And with our online learning platform Relay, we only launched a few months ago, and in PNG right now there's a lot of people now have signed up over the past 2 weeks because schools have been closed. So I've had been talking to a few people around PNG who are now signed up, and they're actually delivering their content or their learning content through Relay, and the stories are amazing because you've got mothers who are trying to educate their children, but their children are in rural Papua New Guinea because all schools are closed, so they're still able to deliver their content through our online learning platform. So it's actually been very, very good for our online businesses.
And how is the situation in PNG with the COVID-19?
At the moment, as you know, in PNG, there's over 80% of the people live in rural areas. We don't really have the proper infrastructure for testing, so the number is not accurate. However, we have not had any deaths that have been on media or televised, as well as there's no accurate number of infectious rates. So at the moment, it's just normal.
Okay, thanks. Maybe Max, you can jump on it as you are in the same industry as Samson, but in Cambodia. So giving again the situation with COVID-19 in general in Cambodia and with what you're doing with Milk Temple Group.
Yes, so for Cambodia, it's been quite a bad situation actually since February, so since the Chinese New Year. We have seen that Cambodia has 4 economic pillars. One is tourism, the other one is agriculture, manufacturing, and property. So actually, tourism and manufacturing are being hit very hard. Siem Reap is a very well-known destination for international tourism. And today you can visit the Angkor Wat Temple with nobody around you. So it's, it's unseen for the last 30 years. So there is a lot of business that are actually very suffering a lot. We can see hotels closing. We can see people losing jobs, especially also in the manufacturing, where there is no raw material coming from China, so people cannot ship, cannot manufacture in Cambodia and ship in Europe. So it's quite hard situation here for Cambodia. We can see that people might be pushed back under the poverty line. So it's a very strong issue for the economy right now. On the food delivery side, yes, we are on food delivery. In general, all type of delivery are going well. I can see last mile delivery going very well. People ordering all type of items online. We can see food delivery booming with a lot of competition now. I mean, 4 or 5 startups right now are sharing the market. Grocery delivery was a very little thing before this COVID-19. It was not something that people were used to do. Actually, now it has become quite popular with order that has boomed as well during March and April. So in general, I think we have, for the e-commerce, we have gained 2 or 3 years of e-readiness in Cambodia. So people have been forced to use online ordering services, but the economy is hit very bad.
Thanks. Let's move to Nepal. So Binit, if you can give us as well a little bit of insights on how it's going in Nepal, the general situation, tourism, etc., obviously, and in your industry with PropTech.
Thanks, Axel. So in our country, I think the situation is quite okay. It's not very bad. There are testings going on. We have 58 infected as of yet. And the tests are still going. From last 38 days, we've been in lockdown. It's kind of a soft lockdown. We don't have curfew or anything. We can still go to buy groceries like around your area or your neighborhood, but we cannot go to the main roads or we cannot travel anywhere. So far it's okay, but people are still, people have started to get very anxious now because it's been 38 days staying in your home. It's very unnerving, you know. So, but for the economy, I think it's going really bad because I think most of our revenue comes in from remittance as well as tourism, and there's zero tourists now, so it's very bad. All the manufacturing side of things, it's closed. I think one thing we have in common is that the food delivery services, they're doing good. Also, the digital payment has gained a foothold. A lot of people moving into digitalization. So I think one point of it is good. And I think for our business, it's been on hold because people can't see property unless it's online. So even if they see online, property is something that you want to touch and feel. So since people can't go outside, they can't use our businesses. But then it has helped us bring in a lot of users because they want to post their property online so that once everything is over, you know, they can get business as well as us.
Yes, thanks. Quite interesting because we see that it's really different, the situation with the outbreak itself in the different countries. But all the countries are quite protecting themselves, obviously, with lockdowns, curfews, and things like that. And to finish with those countries, maybe Adi, if you can give us a quick view on the situation in Indonesia. I know there was a lot of tourists from Australia going to Indonesia, especially Bali, especially at that time of the year with the holidays. But how is the situation in Indonesia and with your business in the infrastructure?
I think it's been quite similar with what is happening to other countries as well. And in Indonesia, there are a lot of people in my country that depend on tourism and hospitality services, like you said. And as far as I know, it's dying. And also, are people here so highly social? You can find people holding on even on a daily basis here. We call it like Selamatan, Arisan, and other. When this world pandemic came, EO, catering, hotels, and other businesses that providers need are the first one to decline. And also, there are example company try to dim pivot and at their basis. Like a local fast food restaurant, they try to transform their business into providing basic needs like rice, sugar, milk, which they provide to their supplier, and they pretty successfully did that. Luckily, through Jagon Hosting, business is still not impacted. Demand on our services have increased dramatically in recent months. Our product VPS even run out of stock, and that's when our government limits people movement, making it hard for us to install our new servers since our servers in a neighboring city. but thanks to OVH, server provider, they have been great to help us. They provide servers what we need, and just one click from home, and we're back in our business. And also, OVH can deliver servers with our high standard. So I think so lucky for our business.
Thanks, Adi. Sorry, I was having some issues with my mute button anyway. Thanks for those infos. What are the government reactions or helps or subsidies in your markets, maybe in Papua New Guinea, Samson? Are there some actions from the government to support startups or SMBs?
Yeah, so obviously, you know, with a developing country, we've got issues of our own, you know. The first thing that they would have done is they applied for funding for this COVID-19, a medical facilities to be set up to properly test and combat that. And with regards to supporting businesses, there hasn't really been much at all. It's more so the banks that have tried to lower the interest rates to help support businesses, whether they wanted loans and to prolong payments, but it hasn't been a real significant help, to be honest. But then if you look at the cases, PNG only has, you know, eight cases officially, the whole country, no deaths. So I would say that the only real impact in terms of businesses operating would be, you know, tourism or the people flying in and out for holidays or work. That's all the borders are shut at the moment. So that would sort of impact that particular area. But most business would be operating as usual with the curfew in place.
Thanks. Binit, do you have, are there some actions from the governments as well in Nepal? Or?
A lot of industries, they're asking for some subsidies, but the government hasn't taken any actions as of yet. Just yesterday, Alliance for Startups, especially tech startups, they presented a letter of they presented a letter to the Prime Minister saying that we need some subsidies in the startups as well. But so far, they haven't taken any action, not for any industry. And looking at it, I think they'll bring in packages. Packages for, I think, agriculture or some businesses. But as far as I can see, I don't think they'll bring any packages for startups or any other SMBs. I don't know.
Max, do you see some actions in Cambodia or?
In Cambodia, there's been quite a lot of surveying those days. We have like a startup community group that we are answering surveys and all. So there will be probably like tax cut or maybe a discount on electricity bill. For sure, most of the business, especially in Siem Reap or Phnom Penh, they could negotiate like discount on the rent. So office rent has been discounted for tourism, for sure. As well as the healthcare has been free for people infected by COVID-19. There also been a plan for manufacturing employees to maintain a minimum wage of I think $40 per month for those who lost their jobs, and in the tourism industry, a huge tax break for the year. But it's been implemented.
Yes, it's quite interesting. So we organize as well surveys each time we run these events online and on the community, and asking startups and entrepreneurs what they are doing with how they are doing during these tough times. And for example, we asked the question, you just received the poll on Zoom right now, and 76% of the attendees say that they are finding new opportunities, while only 5% are in sleep mode. world. So it's quite interesting, I think, and it's not dependent on emerging or more mature markets or whatever, but everyone is trying to find new opportunities within their business, new strategies and new things to put in place to survive the crisis. Maybe Samson, if you can react on that, on what you've been doing, especially with the PNG business and maybe with the EdTech business, which types of techniques or strategies you've put in place to go through this year?
Yeah, so with the ordering business, we know that a lot of people now can't really go out, and so and the restaurants are closed, so we're receiving more orders. So in order to kind of keep growing that interest, we're now doing sort of loyalty vouchers. So if you order 10 or more, then you get your next meal free. So we're trying to implement that right now into our web platform, and obviously increasing our drivers, the amount of drivers that are delivering the foods from these restaurants, and even because we've been receiving a lot of interest from other restaurants wanting to come on board our platform for us to deliver their food. So we just have to increase our staff with that. And with the online learning with Relay, we're trying to piggyback off a lot of the what's been talked about with Zoom. So recently we integrated Zoom into Relay. Because there's been a lot of talk about Zoom being used. So we're trying to use what's hot out there, what's been talked a lot about. And so instead of just using Zoom outside of your education experience, you can just log in with Relay and on our online learning platform and use Zoom inside there to make it more convenient.
Thank you. Maybe Binit, if you can detail a bit what you've been doing once again as an entrepreneur or as a founder with your team, your teams on the ground, etc., with the business. And as a business with your customers that are, as you said, a bit in sleep mode as there's no property activity going on right now?
So our team has been working, especially our tech team, they've been working on refining our product. The sales, marketing, and people operations, all these teams are really in the sleep mode because they actually don't have anything to do. But our tech team, especially the mobile as well as the backend team, they're working a lot in refining our product. I think because once we come out of this pandemic, or let's say another a month or so, we want to be better. We want to be more reliable. We want to do services that people actually expect, because I think this will be the new normal for another a year or so. People don't want to go out much. People don't want to mingle much. They rely on virtual things or virtual management or everything. So I think once we get off this, once it starts becoming a bit normal, I think the business will really take off. For now, yeah. So everybody else is on sleep mode except for the tech.
And for your customers, are you trying to find new ways to retain them, to keep them interested, to postpone payments, to do advertising differently?
We've been in constant contact with our customers, the existing ones as well as the potential ones. And we have postponed all their payments because they're not getting anything out of it. And we as a business, I think we should consider our clients because they're the ones making the business happen. So for other things, for the new clients, for the prospects, what we are doing is we are trying to provide them with resources, a lot of training materials so that they can be ready when we come out of this. And yeah, for the existing client as well, we're talking a lot of it with them. We're trying to train them with new things, whatever we're launching or whatever we are making now, we're trying to train them with that so that they're ready when the business actually happens.
Thanks, Binit. And maybe Max, a similar business as what Samson is doing in PNG with GoFood, but what have you been doing so in Cambodia and in the other markets you are in as well, in terms of strategies and other things to put in place to survive this thing?
So of course we have received a lot of demand from new restaurants that want to start delivery. I mean also high-end restaurants that adapted their offering. So we have been following up on making sure we can put everybody online in the last few weeks. Also, because everybody is scared to go out. Actually, we are not under lockdown, but people don't go out. We are like diversifying into categories. So we have integrated pharmacies for delivery. We have integrated some beauty shops as well, supermarkets like Minimart directly for delivery in 30 minutes. So we are trying to diversify the offer mostly.
Okay. And maybe Adi, so in Indonesia, you're more onto the infrastructure or cloud online business only. What have you been putting in place to survive the crisis, even if for you it's you're not that much impacted, but what are the things that you've been trying to put in place with the teams and the strategies?
We try to catch all opportunity came up to our to our business, especially at our business to catch the value in this situation. We make more feature to our servers to catch low and middle business can operate online website or marketing more easier, because a lot of people try to migrate from conventional business to online business. And this is so good positive impact at Indonesia, because more people is to be more educated to using online media. And other things, we make more help support and consultant to bring their people media can running and have a catch customer. So for me as a product manager at our business, I think the key, we must try to catch everything what people need and at whatever condition of the crisis, because always there's opportunity at every moment. And also, especially at Jago Nursing, we so happy because we already have ISO 27001. It is so help us to across this crisis because there are risk and opportunities management to help us to draw the future of business and how much we do when we have a crisis like this.
Thanks. Maybe just to go back on the markets themselves, Samson, what is the... How do you feel, how do you see people, the population on the ground, like here in Australia and in Papua New Guinea? Do you feel that the reaction from people are kind of similar? Are they more scared, less scared, willing to change their habits or way they do things after this? What's your comparison between those two markets?
Yeah, I mean, they're two separate worlds, totally yeah. Different worlds. And I think for us in Australia here, this is the new norm, working online, communicating online, pivoting very quickly to change our offerings and to, you know, try bring services online. Whereas in PNG, well, you know, more than 80% of the people live in rural Papua New Guinea. And so everyone's self-sufficient anyway. And the cases and the severity there is unknown, and officially there hasn't been much of an impact in terms of the health, but there are opportunities that now people are looking at. For example, if you look at the internet payment gateway now available for Papua New Guineans there, now people are aware that you can do business within, you know, locally, globally, from PNG. So that's also presenting them opportunities through this season, because a lot of people are now getting aware of, you know, what you can do online. And so, yeah, I think it's only positive, to be honest, moving forward for both countries and people just exploring other opportunities.
And if we can compare something maybe more comparable, but Sydney with Port Moresby, how are people reacting? Do you feel that they are underreacting, or are they once again a bit scared with all that, or because you don't have so many known cases in PNG, is it like they don't know what's happening really? Or,
well, I think the way people, I guess, in PNG react to what's online can be quite dramatic, very emotional, because of, you know, whether what's fact and what's fiction. So sometimes it can be an overreaction. So they would be reacting with panic. Whereas here in Australia, everyone, you know, more exposed to what's facts and what's fiction, and they can make their own judgment and they want a sense of freedom. And so I think people here think that everyone's overreacting in terms of this whole COVID-19 situation. But Australia is a gateway to the Pacific, really, because you have all sorts of influx of people traveling in from other parts of the world who have, you know, caught the virus somehow and brought it in, whereas PNG weren't really cases, because it's not a gateway for travelers coming from all around the world. So yeah, they're two different.
And maybe Binit, in Nepal, how is the people reaction in the streets of Kathmandu? I guess it's pretty empty now in the streets, and everyone staying at home, or?
Most people are staying at home. The reaction is quite normal, as of like any pandemic, and this scary one, because it's a virus and it can kill you. So yeah, people are really scared. And I think the reaction is quite normal in this situation. They're not overreacting to anything from my point of view. They're staying at home, but a lot of people, since, you know, Kathmandu is like a hub for the whole country, so a lot of people from outside, they want to go back, because they can't pay their rentals, people living in daily wages, they cannot earn their living, so they want to go outside. And in that part, I think the government has helped a lot as well, taking them to their places free of charge, you know, getting them food and everything. Even the local communities, they've been providing food and shelter and all these things. So because this is not the first time for us in the recent memory, because 5 years ago we had a devastating earthquake and it was a similar situation. And I think the reaction is quite normal to that. And yeah, so far it's okay, not bad.
And maybe in Cambodia, and what you've been seeing maybe in Laos and Myanmar as well, Max?
So Cambodia is not on lockdown, but people are genuinely staying home, taking security measures, wearing masks, washing hands. You can see protective gears at every entry of the shops. But in general, I think frontier markets, people cannot afford to stay under lockdown. So there is this need to get out and work, bring income to home. So yes, it's a luxury to be able to be confined for weeks, actually. And this is not the case for Cambodians.
And have you seen things differently in Laos and Myanmar, or how is it there?
So Myanmar and Laos are confined, but so I couldn't go there actually since February. Actually, I heard the same things, that they can't go anywhere, but also at the end of the day, you need to put rice on the plate. So people are very eager to get back to work, actually. Of course, they are afraid, but you need to eat every day. So those countries have $150 to $200 income per month before the crisis. So genuinely, after 4 or 5 weeks, if you haven't received any income, you don't have enough to sustain if you stay in the big city. Of course, if you go back to the province, you can be self-sufficient as well with the families and the vegetables and rice. But in the big cities, people need to work.
Yeah. And if you would see the situation in your countries after the lockdown, the confinement, etc. You were saying before, Max, that it was a good acceleration for digital stuff, etc. Maybe Samson, as you were as well saying about PNG with online payments, etc. I know you've been active in that as well. What's your view on how it could be on the positive side of things after this whole outbreak? How would you see it, or would you like to see it, and how do you think it would be possibly?
Yeah, I think very, very positive. As I said before, and as we all know, that this has become the new norm, and using digital platforms or digital technology to increase your business opportunities now will obviously generate that interest in the moving forward. And so I think business will do very, very well. Obviously, depending on, you know, what kind of business you're in. With the food platform that we have there, it is very popular in Port Moresby. That serves just under 1 million people, but we're only based in Port Moresby. We're not based anywhere else. We do want to expand throughout the other parts of PNG and the Pacific. Whereas my online learning platform is a global learning platform, so it is a SaaS product that can scale immediately. And you know, we're piggybacking off these hot topics of delivery, hot topics of online learning. And so I think we're very positioned well. And with that, you know, people will have to pivot, and people will have to learn a little bit more about what it takes to have an online presence, what it takes to have some sort of technology to complement your business to, you know, increase opportunities, whether it be locally or on a national scale or global scale, depending on what type of business you run. So only positive from here on in. Very excited for everyone in PNG.
And from the other stories you've heard in the country, do you have other interesting facts from other entrepreneurs and startups or entrepreneurs per se in PNG?
Yeah, so with the Internet Payment Gateway project that I was working on, that became a reality only a few weeks ago. And one of my customers was able to get her payment system on board her website. And so right now, literally every day, she's receiving payments by credit card from customers in Australia and New Zealand. And she never had that before. So you're having Australian dollars or New Zealand dollars or foreign currency coming into the country through her online payment platform and hitting PNG in Kina, which is the local currency there. So that's only good for foreign trade. It's great for her business to grow. And she's seeing exponential growth already in 2 weeks since we implemented that. So now that opportunity is available for any individual local business across Papua New Guinea, which will truly, you know, give them a different mindset. It'll spark something in them to create something online, to have the services online, and for them to receive payments in local currency from anywhere around the world. And I know very well that I've received so many emails and inquiries about that particular system. So we've escalated those customers into the bank system, and now they're getting registered for their payment gateway.
So you feel that with these types of technologies, it could skip intermediaries and allow local PNG SMBs to export products throughout the world, get paid in Kina, things like that, yeah?
Absolutely. It'll only be very good for the Papua New Guinea economy and for obviously global trade. But you know, we're also reliant on internet. So these businesses, wherever they're located, must have access to good, fast, cheap, reliable internet, which is something that I'm sure there are many providers now out there working on satellite internet across Papua New Guinea. I've had numerous conversations with them, and that can only really increase opportunities for our people to export their goods and services, but also to get out of that mindset of thinking just to sell a product locally, because we have that mindset back in PNG where I'm just going to sell this to John, Tom, just across the road. But no, that can also be across the state or province or in another country as well. So this would really open up that mindset to think globally and produce products that can actually be suitable for a global production or global use.
Great, amazing. And Binit, how do you see the... at least Nepal after the outbreak, like what do you think will have accelerated or leapfrogs in terms of technology adoption, things like that?
I'm inclined to agree with Samson here. So what we what we are facing now has accelerated the growth of online payments mostly. And people are adapting quite quickly because there's no other way. People can't really go out and buy things. Even if they can, they're really scared that the virus will transfer through the money or something like that. So it has really been great for online payment wallets and gateways and all these things. And it has also helped a part of the economy which has been really, really slow in growth. We already had like two or three wallets here, but people were not using that much. But for now, everything, they're using that. Even the online presence of companies, they have really grown because, like I said, it's the new normal. So people have to virtualize everything. People have to get online. People know the importance now to be online. So I think it'll be really, really good in coming days. Even for us, it's really easy now because we've been in the online marketplace for last four or five years. And people are really getting to know us now. Those people who have not been very active online. I think it's good. It's good for the country as well as the process of digitalization.
And do you feel it's pushing as well the local governments to regulate things easier and better with online payments, e-wallets, and things?
Those things were actually pretty much regulated from the start. We had some issues. We had some issues with other things like ride sharing and all those things. But for online, especially in the payment sector, everything is really regulated because we don't have the country, we don't have much money. So we have to save the money that we have. And people are really protective about this. And especially in the online thing, good companies or really big companies are doing this. And they're quite good with it. And I think the government is doing its part to accelerate that growth as well.
And Samson, just to jump back on PNG quickly, but have you seen some increased interest from the governments in these times as well? Like they want to ease regulation or make things happen faster or in these online payment things? Or?
Well, I mean, the banks are the ones that are really governing this, not the government. So with the particular project that I worked on, it was through the Bank of South Pacific, which is the biggest bank in PNG and across the South Pacific. But the government is aware about it. So we're now working on a project with the government to integrate that in one of their websites and systems. But yeah, it's pretty much all financed by the bank. So they're in control of it.
Okay, thanks. And Max, maybe if you can jump on this as well, what's your view on how things can be, will be after all this, and especially, of course, in the tech startup ecosystem? Unmute your microphone. Yeah, oops.
Good. For sure, there is an opportunity for the youth, the youth people that have e-readiness, have digital literacy. I think we will see a shift from all manufacturing to service industry. So there is an opportunity to build skills for the next generation, online skills, ability to sell products and services online. So this is an opportunity because it takes you out of manufacturing and agriculture industry. So I'm quite positive with this. Of course, the online payment is booming. We had a lot of, a big part of the population was unbanked, but we have like for 10 years, we have a remittance app. So this has been quite popular during the pandemic. I see some fintech companies have done some effort on their pricing. So now remittance is free from wallet to wallet. So in general, I think people will realize more that technology can help them through their life, and they have been used to it. we have the chance that 4G is really cheap in Cambodia. So the smartphone penetration is quite good as well. So yes, it's for a few weeks, it has been focusing people online. So it's also a good education. I believe that for the kids also that had the opportunity to learn from home and learn from a computer, this is some kind of skill that they acquired using computers at a very young age. So yeah, I think it's positive for the future.
And maybe if you can share some things you've seen with other startups or entrepreneurs in Cambodia or in the other markets you are in, things you've seen and you find interesting.
I believe there is a big need of digitization of the businesses. So I've seen some startups, I think of Tuesday Cambodia, that is helping social sellers with their inventory management and with their selling marketing on Facebook. So there will be a new behavior, consumption behavior for sure. We can see that some startups are really taking the opportunity to push people to help them to sell online. I think, of course, POS companies will do well, especially if they make the effort to digitize small businesses. Of course, there is a lot of training needed. I believe that marketplace like Amazon or Alibaba will do well also, because we will have all these merchants that realize that they can't only sell offline and they have to adapt themselves. So yes, in terms of, there is few startups that are helping people to get online, that are helping them to be digitized. And I think this is quite promising for them. They are in a really good space. It's like food delivery. It's a really good space to be now.
Thanks. And maybe, Adi, if you can share your view on how do you think it will be in Indonesia after the outbreak? Do you think it will accelerate things in terms of digitization? Do you think everyone will, as you're in this business, want to have their, of course, their website, a more online presence, etc.? What's your view on that?
Like what we see now, because at Indonesia, people become more aware of online media. It can be used for anything with easy and fast. And people will try to meet their need with online media, like for healthy service and education, or try to be something like working and other. This make people at Indonesia be useful and more educated with using online media to meet their needs. Opportunities will come up from infrastructure like internet, link, gadget, until service business. And what I see at Indonesia after this pandemic, I see maybe will come up a lot of local and home-based industry. They will grow more faster than before. And this is will take a lot of people to make a business and work. And so this is also a opportunity to like service business, like delivery service or marketplace, because local and home-based industry also have from marketplace to promote their product.
Thanks. Maybe jumping quickly on a few questions from the attendees. One for you, Samson. What do banks need to do in order to enable online payment gateway systems to be taken up by SMBs?
Yeah, so at the moment, I can only share my experience with working with the Bank of South Pacific, BSP. Yeah. And right now, you can, in fact, apply to get your merchant accounts and IDs created. So it's not an open-ended way where, you know, in other developed nations, we can actually tap into the APIs and create our own internet payment gateway ourselves. As developers, we have to actually, in PNG, go through the bank. They have to manually create those accounts. And then those accounts have to be created with the payment gateway technology. And then the web developer comes and gets those two ends to talk to each other. So there is still a bit of a manual process going on, but if anyone wants to get have that done, then you can just contact me and I can put you through. They will send you an application form plus a list of requirements that you need to fulfill before you can get your merchant IDs and accounts created, and then the internet payment gateway can be integrated.
And do you think banks will be willing to change their infrastructure and their way to proceed after the COVID to push more the online transactions? Or
I hope so. I really do hope so. Then it'll just kind of be a seamless seamless exercise, really, because at the moment there's a lot of manual processes going on still. But the solution is only for Papua New Guinean account holders. Even though BSP has a presence in other Pacific nations, it's actually not available for other BSP banks in Vanuatu or Solomon Islands or Fiji. It's not available yet for them.
Okay. And another question from the attendees, maybe for you, Max, about capital raising in emerging markets. What's your view and what have you seen recently, especially with the COVID-19 outbreak? We had a previous session before about just about that topic. And basically, of course, investors, angels, etc., a bit changing the way they are doing those due diligence and things like that. What's your reaction on that?
For the last, let's say, last 6 weeks, we haven't been very focused on fundraising, actually. This is kind of a full-time job. So right now we are being focused on the business. I believe the next fundraising, the next way to raise funds is to get revenues. So actually, we are focusing on revenues now, and we didn't contact any investors potential since 6 to 8 weeks.
And so you, Samson, maybe when you speak about emerging markets to potential angels or investors, what are your views on that? What are their reactions, especially if you have been speaking with them recently or at least discussing it?
Yeah, we've had a few people in Papua New Guinea actually approach GoFood PNG for investment, who are interested to invest into the company, but we haven't held any formal talks yet because, like Max said, we're a fully sustainable business. We make profit every year, and we started from absolute scratch, from nothing, and so we've been able to build a sustainable business over 3 years. But the time will come where, you know, if we want to be expanding a lot more quicker across the Pacific, then we may look into raising a little bit of seed capital to help us expand. And nowadays, I find that you have a few individuals who are open to investing inside of PNG in emerging markets, but even externally as well. We've had conversations with other companies from outside the country who are interested in investing into startups in an emerging economy.
You're mute.
Sorry, thanks. Samson, just how is the capital raising in PNG currently with angel investor or more sophisticated investor, just in general, before the outbreak?
Well, I know that there are a few funds getting started up now in PNG because it's becoming a lot more active. I have not had any experience yet in terms of raising finance inside of PNG for those businesses in PNG, because in emerging economies, it's quite tough to kind of, you know, make it. So, you know, we've had to build everything from nothing without investment. So unfortunately, I can't share any experience on getting investment from angel or VCs there, because it's kind of something that's not really active in Papua New Guinea.
And maybe, Binit, if you can react on capital raising from a Nepalese perspective.
Nepali VCs have been quite active for the past few years, I think one or two. A lot of people investing in a lot of technology companies, especially the food industry, as well as the agri-tech which is in on a rise now. A lot of people investing in that, since Nepal is already an agricultural country, and bringing technology into it, I think it's really, really good. But from our part, we haven't talked to any local investors as of yet. We're not in talks with anything. And since we're still you know, running our businesses, and we are sustainable, but I don't know how long this outbreak will last. And at one point, maybe we need to raise once again. But at this point, we're not talking to anybody. And but they're quite active in Nepal, and they've been investing.
And maybe to finish this panel today, guys, if you could share some tips and advice from, once again, your personal experience or what you've heard, etc., to other entrepreneurs and in emerging markets or more mature markets. Maybe let's start with you, Samson. To go through this pandemic and after, of course, yeah.
So two things. First thing is, you know, understanding your market and be willing to pivot very quickly, because the market really shifted within weeks of this of what happened this year with the COVID-19. So in order to survive, we have to be open to learning, open to pivot into a different direction, and really quickly transform our business to have different offerings. And remain flexible and fluid like that, because you know it can, the climate can really change very quickly, which is what's been happening. So that would be my first advice for people in emerging markets. And the other one is to not think locally, but think globally. So when you're coming up with a business idea or a solution, don't just think about solving an issue. It may be your own problem or your own pain point, but think of how you can actually scale that. Like, can I have it working in PNG? Yes. Can I have it working in Asia or in Australia or in America? Yes. Well, you have to think globally in order to really create a big, massive business so that you can survive that the test of time in different kind of climates. So, yeah, that'll be my two tips.
Thanks, Samson. Maybe we need some advice for fellow entrepreneurs.
I think the main point should be that people should stay positive in these times, because like every other pandemic, this will pass as well. And what you need to do, or what you require to do, is as I've been focusing throughout this panel, is virtualizing your business. So if you're not active online, you'll be at a great loss. And I think this is the very right time to do that, because everything is slow. Everything is everything has changed. Everything has become a different thing. So I think getting online now will be the best thing to do, and staying positive should be good as well.
Maybe Adi, some advice as well for entrepreneurs in Indonesia. Oh, your microphone as well.
Because after this pandemic, I think will come a lot of opportunity, like from healthy service, education, something. Maybe entrepreneur can try to catch this opportunity with try to provide some services or feature at can access by mobile or internet. I think that's a big opportunity for at Indonesia.
And maybe to finish, Max, some advice for entrepreneurs as well.
Yeah, I think it's a good time to start a business, actually. So when I was a student, it was in 2008. My teacher told me, you are lucky, you are students now. When you will be graduated, it will be the after crisis time. So now it's a good time to start to think about what will be the world in few months, in 1 year and a half or two. And it's the really good time to ask yourself what will be the need and what will be the consumption. So I think it's interesting time for new entrepreneurs right now, and there will be great ideas ahead.
Great, thanks. Thanks guys for joining today. Thanks all of you for answering those questions, sharing your views from an emerging market perspective, etc. And I think this touch of positivity is great, as you said, Binit. With the last poll we we did on the chat, almost 70% of the attendees are adjusting quite well to the work from home situation and the whole situation, and 20+% are living the best of their lives. So yes, work from home can unlock opportunities, can generate ideas, etc. And I think yes, there will be many things to do after after this. And as you said, Samson, pivoting and adapting as fast as possible is a great way to overcome this. Thanks guys again for joining today. Thanks to all the attendees. And you receive an email to connect further. Don't forget to connect on Startup and Angels community online. You can find links on the different emails we've received and on our website. And you can continue the discussion there. There's entrepreneurs looking for co-founders, for investors, there's mentors, there's angels, etc. in there. So feel free to go there, browse and discuss. Thanks again, guys. Have a good day. Rainy day here in Sydney, Australia. Winter is coming. So and stay safe. See you guys.
Yeah, see you. Thank you.
Thanks all. Yeah.